Thank you very much, Professor Allitt. Thank you all for being here. It is such an honor for me to have the opportunity to deliver not just any old lecture as part of the voluntary corps program here at Emory, but the very first one of the academic year. It's a great privilege for me to be part of this program. And it's a great privilege for me to be part of this enterprise, the broader enterprise of helping to educate young people more broadly about the civilization that we are such an integral part of and its roots and what makes it great. And so I'm really, really privileged to have an opportunity to be part of this program to talk to you here today. My subject is seeing structure in architecture. The underlying premise of this talk is that if we look through the ages at the great works of architecture that are so integral to our culture, so integral to Western civilization, if we look very closely at those works of architecture, we'll find that they have been profoundly influenced, not just by the culture from which they emerged, not just from the aesthetic tastes that happened to have been in vogue at the time that those great structures emerged, but also they are profoundly influenced by the underlying principles of engineering, which have been in effect since the dawn of time, and which caused them in many instances to be the way they are. My premise then is that if we learn just a little bit about these basic principles of engineering, enough to understand how those principles influenced the design of our great buildings, our great bridges, our great towers and structures through the ages, then we can appreciate those great structures in a far more compelling way, in a much richer way, in a much broader way. And that's what today's talk is all about. Now, it's a huge, broad subject. We can't possibly look at all great structures that have been designed and built through the ages. So in the interest of focus, I'm going to address this topic in the context of a single structural element, the arch, as you can see on my title slide. As such, if the arch is going to be the focal point of our discussion today, then you might guess which great ancient civilization I'll be starting this discussion with. What do you think? I heard Rome. It's the logical answer. You can hardly think about ancient Rome without thinking about arches. The arches of the great triumphal archways through which the legions marched, the arches of the great Roman aqueducts, the arches of the Colosseum. The arch is practically synonymous with ancient Rome and with ancient Roman architecture. And so it would be quite logical for me to begin this discussion in ancient Rome, except I've never done anything terribly logical, so we're actually going to start with ancient classical Greece. Why? Because you can't really understand the arch and why the arch was really the essence of a revolution in architecture brought about by the Romans. You can't really understand why it was so revolutionary until you understand the architectural context from which the arch emerged. And that context is the architecture of Rome's great predecessor, classical Greece. Okay, so if we're going to start with the architecture of classical Greece, then we will certainly begin where? What's the first thing that comes to mind when you think of the architecture of classical Greece? The Parthenon, of course. That's the logical starting point, because not only is the Parthenon the epitome of classical Greek architecture, it's also quite representative. The fact is that virtually every monumental building constructed in the entire classical Greek era use the same fundamental underlying structural system as you see here represented in the Parthenon, constructed in the middle of the 5th century BC. That same fundamental structural system for virtually every monumental building built during this entire era. And that structural system, I'm going to switch to a different classical Greek temple here. This is the Temple of Juno in a place called Agrigento in Sicily. Yes, there were classical Greek era colonies that built Greek temples, just like the Parthenon, in Sicily during that same era. This building is actually a little earlier than the Parthenon, the Temple of Juno at Agrigento, and I use this as an example because it's actually an easier representation. It's a little easier for you to see this great underlying structural system, which is called the post and lintel system. Now, post and lintel is an architectural term. An engineer, being simple folk, we would simply call this a beam and column structural system. The post of the post and lintel system is the column, and you see two of them here, and the lintel of the post and lintel system is a beam that spans from column to column. All monumental architecture in the classical era was done in stone, so what we're looking at specifically here is the fundamental underlying structural system used throughout the classical Greek era, the stone post and lintel system. What's so special about this structural system, and why am I talking about it as a prelude to the arch, as a revolutionary innovation that came about during the Roman era? To answer that question rigorously, we need to start with a little bit of basic structural mechanics. In any structure, whether it's the Parthenon, or the Colosseum, or this building that we're sitting in today, every element of every structure made by humans can carry load in only two possible ways. In only two possible ways. Okay? Here's one. I want you to hold on to that end, nice and tight. This is one. Now, the load is being applied to this structural element, and that load is applied in a way that causes the element to stretch or elongate. The word we use to represent that form of structural load carrying is what? Who knows it? I heard it. Tension. This is tension. Very nice. Another way to look at tension here, that where you can see it a little bit more closely, is when I pull on this element in a way that causes it to elongate, you'll notice if you look very closely that the black lines on this element get a little farther apart. That's tension. The opposite of tension is what? Compression. Very good. So compression is caused by an external loading applied to the element that causes it to get shorter, to squash. And so under compressive loading, you'll notice that the black lines get closer together. Okay? Now let's apply your newfound knowledge to an understanding of the stone post and lintel construction system. Here's a post and lintel structure. I've got two columns and a beam. How are the columns carrying load? Tension or compression? I heard both answers. How many say tension? Tension is losing popularity rapidly. How many say compression? Yes, that's a very good call. We've got a big, massive stone beam up here that's pushing down on the columns. Therefore, the columns are being squashed. The columns are in compression. Ah, now here comes the tough one. How is the beam carrying load? Tension or compression? How many say tension? A few timid souls. Good. Thank you for the courage of your convictions. How many say compression? How many don't know? How many say both? Ah, very good. For lack of another alternative, the answer is both. One of the reasons beams are such fascinating examples of structural mechanics is that they experience both tension and compression simultaneously. And if you don't believe me, look at the black lines. When a beam bends, and all beams do this, you don't see this much exaggerated deformation in the beams that are holding up the ceiling above our heads, but it's happening on a much smaller scale. When a beam bends, notice that the black lines get closer together where? Up on top, they get farther apart on bottom. So a fundamental characteristic of a beam is that it carries load in bending, and when it bends, it compresses on the top, and it stretches, or it's in tension on the bottom. Who cares? Why is this important? Well, the reason this is so important is in the very first word on my slide, stone. Stone as a structural material is very strong in one direction and it's very weak in the other. Which is which? How is stone weak? Stone weak. Go ahead. That's true. It does expand and contract and develop cracks, though you misunderstood my question. The point I'm getting to is that stone is much, much, much stronger in compression than in tension. Okay, now you don't think of it because you pick up a rock and you pull on it, you can't pull it apart. But if you found some relatively weak limestone or sandstone, you actually could pull it apart in tension. Stronger limestone or granite or marble, is strong enough that you can't pull it apart in tension, but if you use it in a structural application like this, or if you tested it in a hydraulic testing machine, you would find out that stone is at least 10 times stronger in compression than it is in tension. That's a problem. It's not a problem for columns, right? Columns carry load entirely in compression. So stone is really the ideal building material for a column, since it's really strong in compression, and columns simply get compressed. But in a beam, we have approximately equal compression on the top and tension on the bottom. But stone does not have approximately equal strength in tension and compression. So if this beam is made of stone, and I subject it to a progressively increasing load, where's it going to fail? Bottom, where? Let's do a test. This is actually not stone, believe it or not. But this is actually a reasonable facsimile of stone in terms of the fact that it's styrofoam, but its styrofoam is actually much stronger in compression than it is in tension. And so if I think of this as a stone lintel, and I subject it to increasing transverse load, it's bending, and it fails by snapping on the bottom. The bottom initiated the failure in tension, it cracked, and then the crack propagated through the entire element, and it collapsed. The same thing happens with stone lintels. So how do you think you guard against that kind of failure when you're designing a Greek temple? You know, you're now the architect of a Greek temple. How are you going to prevent that sort of failure from happening as soon as you put your building into service? Sir, go ahead. Fantastic. Exactly right. You've got to put the columns really close together. The farther apart you put the supports on a beam, the greater is its tendency to bend, the greater are the stresses resulting from bending, the more likely a failure occurs. The only way, realistically, reliably, to prevent a stone beam from failing prematurely in tension is to put the columns really close together. Well, have you ever noticed in buildings like the Temple of Juno at Agrigento, the Parthenon, the columns are quite close together. The spacing of the columns. The actual clear space between columns is only just a bit larger than the width of the column itself. The building is almost more column than it is open space. Today, we look at that building and we think, well, that's just the way Greek temples are. That's the aesthetic effect. That's the proportions we have come to expect are associated with the colonnade of columns and beams that constitutes a Greek temple. And we see that form replicated so often in the world around us in neoclassical buildings, we just think of it as a normal aesthetic effect. But it's much more than that. In the spacing of the columns of a Greek temple, we see a fundamental limitation in the stone post and lintel structural system. You simply couldn't move those columns much farther apart and expect this thing to stand up for an extended period of time. Well, you can say, well, we can make the beam bigger too. And in fact, one of the really cool things about Greek temples is that they used an elaborate mathematical system to control the proportions of the entire building. You know, the architect who designed a Greek temple began with the diameter of a column, and from that point forward, every other dimension was already determined by a set of mathematical rules that was formulated early in the classical era and propagated throughout the Mediterranean world. You know, once the column diameter was set, we knew how tall to make the column, how far to space them, how wide should be that architrave beam up on top of the column. Every other dimension of the temple was already predetermined based on those proportions. So you might say, well, we're not just going to make the columns farther apart. We can make the beam larger in proportion as well, and therefore the beam's going to get stronger because it's getting larger. But there's a fallacy in that rationale. What is it? Anybody think about it? We can just keep making the beam bigger in proportion to the column spacing, and everything will be fine. Does that make sense? Go ahead.
It's going to compress too much weight on the columns, as the beam is getting bigger.
Yeah, I mean, the key point that she just said is weight. What happens to the beam as we make it larger in all directions? It obviously gets heavier. And in fact, it gets heavier as a function of the cube of the increase in dimension, right? Because the weight is directly proportional to the volume of stone, and the volume is a function of length times width times height. So if I increase the entire temple in the same proportion, if I double the size of the temple, the weight of the beams will get 8 times larger, 2 to the third. Okay, so there's a point of diminishing returns. In fact, it's quite easy to show mathematically, and I'll spare you the mathematics, but it's quite easy to show mathematically that there is a theoretical upper limit on how large you can make a Greek temple, how large you can scale it up. And once I get to that upper limit, you simply can't make it any bigger, or all of the beams will fail of their own weight. We don't even have to put any extra load on the roof. They'll fail of their own weight. And amazingly, that upper limit is not just a theoretical ideal. It's not just a theoretical construct. It turns out that that upper limit physically existed. It was the Temple of Artemis at Ephesus, one of the seven wonders of the ancient world, the largest Greek temple ever built. Built somewhere around, the last edition of it built somewhere around 300 BC. You could put eight Parthenons inside this building. It is absolutely immense. But if we now pick it apart and we look at it as an engineer rather than as an architect, we would see that the beam, the typical example of an architrave beam that spans from column to column, one of those beams was about 25 feet in span and weighed about 22 tons. And if you do the math, it turns out that that is the theoretical upper limit of how long you can make an architrave beam in stone before it fails under its own weight. So there's a reason why the Temple of Artemis at Ephesus was the largest Greek temple ever built. You simply couldn't make it any bigger without breaking the entire architectural paradigm. So here we see a wonderful example how an underlying structural principle dramatically affected the design of a building that we don't necessarily think of as an engineered structure. And yet it clearly was. The broader issue is that the Greeks' reliance on this classical era stone, post, and lintel structural system was fundamentally limiting in an architectural sense in two ways that we just saw. One, if you're going to try to support a roof or a ceiling or some sort of a horizontal structure, a higher level floor in a multi-story building, you can only move your columns a very short distance apart before we reach a structural limit. And second, there's also an overall maximum limit on the size of a building. We simply can't make the building any larger than a certain upper limit. It's really these two constraints that are at the heart of the impact of the arch as a structural element as it emerged and was exploited during the Roman era. So the arch was one of two Roman solutions to this fundamental problem I'm addressing. But the other alternative, the other way that the Romans attempted to address the fundamental limitation of using stone beams because of their inability to span long distances, was an alternative structural form called the truss. Trusses were used, there are actually some indication that a few Greek structural engineers used the system as well, but like the arch, which also was not invented by the Romans, the truss was exploited by the Romans to a much greater extent than any previous civilization had done. The truss, in very general terms, is a structural system arranged as a series of interlocking triangles. Now, this is a typical example of a Roman truss as it was used in a large building called a basilica. Basilica was used during the Roman era as a large public gathering space, typically used by the local magistrates for administration of justice. It was a building that had to accommodate a large number of people in an enclosed space with a roof overhead. And in the Greek-style post and lintel system, that really couldn't be done effectively because you couldn't create large, uninterrupted interior spaces as you can here. Romans were able to build trusses that could span upwards of 100 feet, which allowed them to create vast, open interior spaces unimpeded by interior columns, which is what you need if you want a big public gathering space for a building like a basilica. The truss served that purpose quite nicely in a way that the post and lintel system was incapable of serving. Okay, trusses are a little hard to understand, so let's look at a much simplified version of the truss in the form of this model. And in the process of talking about trusses and how trusses work, and trust me, we will get to arches. I get to introduce a couple more big ideas from structural mechanics, my all-time favorite subject. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this truss and we're going to subject it to a load. And you know, right now I'm just going to, I'm missing something. One break. I have to duck into the Great Structures Traveling Roadshow here. So I'm going to subject my truss to a load, which I forgot to get out of my suitcase. Here's a load, and it weighs 2 pounds. So this weight really represents the load that would be applied to the ceiling or to the roof of a structure for which this truss serves as the roof support system. And let's say, just for the sake of argument, that that load weighs 2 pounds. Technically speaking, a load is simply a force applied to a structure. Now, what happens? Well, how many of you had a physics course in high school? You admit it. If you had a physics course in high school, you know Newton's second law, which tells us that a force is equal to what? Newton's second. Very good. Mass times acceleration. Force equals mass times acceleration. That tells me that if we have a 2 pound force applied to this truss, the truss has mass, so therefore, the truss must be accelerating in the downward direction, right? Is the truss accelerating in the downward direction? Is it accelerating?
No.
Acceleration requires motion. Is there any motion?
No.
No, it is not accelerating. If it's not accelerating, then that means that there must be other forces acting on this truss. Right? That's counterbalancing the downward 2 pounds. There can be no net force acting on this truss, or it would be accelerating. So what other forces are acting on that truss? Go ahead. The tension is a force that's relevant to the truss, but that tension is entirely internal. It's doing nothing to counterbalance that 2 pounds. Good guess, though. Go ahead. The normal force, which is where? Right, okay. In your physics class, you called that a normal force. Engineers call those things, because there are more of them, more than one of them, reactions. And the reactions can only occur at the points of contact where the structure is in physical contact with terra firma, with the earth or the supporting structure beneath. That's the only place that a force can happen, an external force can happen on the structure. I mean, we know that this load is pushing down. The only other place forces can occur is at contact points between the structure and the world around it. And those two contact points are the ends where the structure is in physical contact with the ground. So I've got 2 pounds down, and the loading is symmetrical, so therefore there must be 1 pound reaction at each point of contact, pushing up, 2 down, 2 up, counterbalances. The net force acting on the truss is 0, and therefore, there's no acceleration. Everybody follow? Okay? So the first effect of loads acting on structures is that they generate reactions. It's a really important thing to file away for future reference. That's the first thing. The second thing we've already started to explore is that external forces acting on structures also cause internal forces. And we already know that there are only two options for internal forces. What are they? Compression and tension. And therefore, the three elements or members that make up this truss must all be in either tension or compression. Theoretically, could be both, but none of them is. So I'll just give you those two alternatives. So what in this truss is in tension? A string. Obviously, the string is in tension. If it were in compression, it would just bunch up and buckle, and it's sort of drawn tight like a violin string, so we know the bottom element, that horizontal element, is in tension. And that's why I made it out of string. The Romans did not use string for their roof trusses. They used wood, but the string makes it much more obvious that element is causing carrying load in tension. The two diagonals are carrying load, as you might expect, in compression. So what you have is a downward force causes the diagonal to compress, It also tends to cause the entire structure to sort of flatten out, but that tendency is resisted by the string, which is pulled in tension, and the whole system is said to be in equilibrium. The loads are in equilibrium with the reactions. And then if we looked internal to the truss, we would find that the compression and the tension are also in equilibrium with each other to keep the entire system in balance. Okay? So that's how a truss works. And that also introduces a couple of really key fundamental concepts about structures. And that's the most important underlying background information in structural mechanics that we have to carry forward into the remainder of this lecture. How does a structure carry load? Well, we just saw two fundamental effects of loads acting on structures. We saw that loads cause external reactions, two down, and then 2 1-pound loads up. And we saw that loads cause internal tension and compression. Each of these modes of load carrying can potentially cause a failure. And obviously, we don't want failures. As a structural engineer, my job is to make sure that the structure carries load safely. And in order to ensure that the structure carries load safely, I need to ensure two things. First, I need to ensure that the supports are strong enough to carry those reactions. Okay, so if we placed my truss on a couple of columns, the columns would need to be capable of carrying a 1-pound downward compressive load. And if they can, then those supports are strong enough to carry load safely. Secondly, the members themselves have to be strong enough to withstand the internal tension and compression forces. And here I can actually demonstrate how this doesn't work. If we subject this truss to ever-increasing downward load, the more load I apply, the more tension is generated in the string across the bottom. And at some, in this case, relatively moderate level of load, the string fails in tension and the structure collapses. So in order to ensure that this structure carries load safely, I have to make sure both that the diagonals are strong enough to carry their compressive force and the horizontal is strong enough to carry its tensile force. Okay, now we're ready to get down to the critical transition to the arch. Suppose you're a Roman engineer and you're designing a basilica. And you've got to span 80 feet overhead to create a roof system to allow for a nice enclosed space for larger numbers of people to gather. And you know that you can use a truss. We know a truss can handle that job effectively. A truss can handle that job effectively because what material were they always made of? What do you think? Wood, sure. As you could sort of guess from my slide with the picture of Vitruvius's basilica, in the ancient world, trusses were only ever made of wood. Why was that? Well, think about what structural materials were available to engineers and builders in the ancient world. What are some of them? Stone, obviously. We've seen, obviously, stone is the most fundamental, the most commonly used building material in the ancient world. We know wood is another option. What other options are there? Marble's another form of stone. Clay, which was used to make brick for brick masonry, and the Romans built a lot of brick structures. I would submit to you that brick is essentially the same as stone in that it's relatively strong in compression and it's extremely weak in tension. In fact, brick structure is much weaker in tension than stone because the mortar joints between the bricks simply pull apart if you subject them to tensile loading. So put brick in the same category as stone. Strong in compression, very, very weak in tension. What else do we have? What other materials? String, right? Good. Rope, not really a viable structural material. I mean, you know there was iron and bronze. There were metals in the ancient world, but there wasn't enough metal, and it couldn't be fabricated with sufficiently high quality to create large-scale structural elements. There were very, very few exceptions to this rule. There are a couple of historical instances of the use of metals in this way, but for normal day-to-day construction, you simply couldn't do it. You couldn't make enough iron or bronze to use metal. We really have covered the gamut. Later in the Roman era, concrete will come into being, but concrete is simply, you know, think of it as man-made stone with all the same benefits and limitations. Very strong in compression, very weak in tension. So there you go. The only building material available to ancient builders that could carry significant tension was wood. It's the only one. And wood does have tensile strength that's comparable to its compressive strength. So it really is well suited for beams and trusses. But what's the problem with wood as a structural material? I'm sorry? It burns. It's highly susceptible to fire damage, insect damage, and rot. It lacks permanence. There's a reason why the Parthenon, that gorgeous stone structure, it had a wooden roof structure. Of course, we have no idea precisely what it looked like because it rotted away, burned away, fell away many, many, many centuries before any moderns had an opportunity to look at it and figure out what it looked like. So wood is a reasonably flexible structural material in that it carries both tension and compression, but it lacks permanence. So you're not going to build the great grand basilica that's going to last for the ages as the Roman engineers wanted to build out of wood. We need another alternative. So now you're the Roman engineer and you have a pretty good qualitative understanding about how trusses work. You would really love to use a truss, but you know it lacks permanence and you want to build a great basilica that's going to last for the ages. You know that this member across the bottom is problematic. That's the one that carries load and tension. You know if you try to make this thing out of stone, it's simply not going to work. And your line of reasoning says, well, how about if I just got rid of that bottom horizontal member and made a truss out of two compression members? Now I have a structure that carries load entirely in compression, so I can make it out of stone, and I don't have to worry about the failure of that bottom member. Well, what's the problem? What's the problem? Right, there's a reason why it used to be triangular and now it's not anymore. I need two volunteers. I need two bold souls. All right, come on up, come on up. You are our Roman engineers. Here's our structure, and here's your task. I want one here, keep the path open so everybody can see the structure from where you're sitting. Our job is we want to make this truss stand up. I mean, right now it's kind of standing on its own, but I think you can see that if I put any load of it all, it's just going to collapse. I need a way for this structure to continue to stand under this loading, and all you're allowed to do to enhance the structural integrity of this truss is to apply additional force to its supports. So what are you going to do to help me out? Go ahead and give it a shot. Let's go ahead and push it back up. Okay, now sort of stand back so everybody can see you. Now I'm going to hang my load on here and see if your proposed solution works. Oh, pretty good. So what are you doing? What are you doing that's so brilliantly solved our problem? Yeah, but the tension member works by pulling inward. What you're doing is pushing inward in exactly the same way from outside the structure. You're lending additional support to the structure. But unlike before, the support of the structure was pushing up, the reactions were pushing up, what you've really done is add another set of reactions. These reactions are horizontal reactions that are pushing inward from the outside. Fantastic job, guys. Go ahead, have a seat. What you have just done, believe it or not, is to create a simple arch. Now you look at this and say, no, 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 that's not an arch. I know what an arch looks like. I've seen lots of arches, they're curved. Well, maybe from an architectural perspective, arches need to be curved. But from an engineering perspective, that is an arch. Why? Because an arch from an engineering perspective has two and only two fundamental characteristics. One, it carries load entirely in compression. And two, it will only stand if it is supported not only from below, but laterally as well. Why the lateral supports? Because we have already seen that the very nature of an arch structure is such that when placed under load, it has a tendency to try to spread out. Under load, it tries to do this. And the only way to cause it to carry load successfully is to restrain that outward movement. That outward movement is called thrust, or lateral thrust. And so the real essence of an arch is that it must provide some sort of a physical mechanism to restrain the lateral thrust that inevitably occurs as a result of loads being applied to that arch. That's what makes an arch an arch. Carries loading compression and requires lateral support to restrain the thrust that occurs to all arches when they're placed under load. With that as background, let's now look at an arch that's obviously, evidently, an arch. This is a great Roman arch bridge called the Pont St. Martin, located in the Alps in northern Italy. It is an absolutely beautiful structure. You look at that and say, that's a stone arch. I've seen lots of stone arch bridges. This is not just any old stone arch bridge. This is the longest spanning stone arch that has survived from antiquity. It is 100-foot span from support to support, 100 feet. When you stand at this structure, when you really stand there down at the base, see those little people down there at the bottom? That is a monumental structure built by the Romans in the first century BC. Let's see if we can't replicate the great work of the Roman engineer who designed and built the Pont St. Martin, the great nameless Roman engineer. Engineers are always nameless. Who built the Pont St. Martin. Let's go ahead and build a model. Okay, how did they do that? How did they build such a monumental structure, 100-foot span across a river valley? One of the other fundamental characteristics of an arch is that it cannot carry load until it's completely built. Right? It needs to be intact. You have to have an arch that spans from one support to the other. Both supports need to be intact before it can work. If it's incomplete, it's incapable of carrying any load whatsoever. So the only way to build an arch is with some sort of a temporary support structure. That structure in the Roman era was called centering. And this is an example of a typical set of centering used for a Roman arch of that era. We'll put the centering in place. And by the way, Romans were astonishingly clever engineers. If you look at the Pont St. Martin closely, you see this little projecting stone at the base and another projecting stone over here. What do you think that's for? I still couldn't hear, sorry. It is the support structure for the centering, for this truss-based centering. Now, somehow you've got to put the centering in place in a way that holds it exactly in the right position. So the Romans built the foundations of the bridge up to this point. They put this projecting stone in place, and then they set their centering right on that ledge. Obviously, it's a lot bigger. It extends all the way across the valley. So that's what held the centering up. Now we're going to start building our arch. We're going to build an arch out of wedge-shaped stones called voussoirs. Voussoirs, that's the architectural term. It is simply a stone block, but it's got this ever so slight wedge shape. Narrow on this side, then on this side. The narrow side goes inward in order to form the curve of the arch. I'm going to build my arch segments two at a time to keep it in balance, all the way up to the top. Now we have one slot left for one voussoir. This last voussoir is often called what? The keystone. Anybody from Pennsylvania? Yes. And what's the name of your state? The Keystone State. Now, I'm from Pennsylvania too, so I think keystones are pretty cool, but I have to tell you from an engineering perspective, keystones are not cool at all. You know, the word keystone seems to imbue upon this element some sort of special magical powers. It is the most important stone in the arch. No, it isn't. It's just another voussoir. It does no function other than it does exactly the same function as all the other voussoirs in the arch. It just happens to be the one on top. Now we've got all of those stones in place. Theoretically, I should be able to pull the centering out and leave behind an intact structure. And indeed, I can. And not only is this an intact structure, this is a structure that's capable of carrying a tremendous amount of weight. I could stand on this without any difficulty at all, demonstrating the amazing power of the arch because, once again, I didn't glue these blocks together. I didn't bolt them together. I didn't hold them together with some sort of adhesive. The only thing holding them together is gravity. And yet, this thing can carry hundreds of pounds of load without any mechanical connectors. That's the power of the arch. Now, the arch has two fundamental characteristics. What are they? Let's test the theory. What's the first? Carries load entirely in. Compression. How do you know this arch is absolutely, unequivocally, certainly, without fail, entirely in compression? How do you know? What would happen if it weren't in compression? What would happen if it's in tension? Okay, here's a little mini arch composed of three voussoirs. If this little mini arch were in tension, that means I have to pull on it, right? How much load can the arch carry if it's in tension? Not much. Simply by virtue of the fact that the stones are remaining in contact with each other, we know that it's entirely in compression. What's the second fundamental characteristic of an arch? Yes, exactly. It experiences lateral thrust, and it will only carry load if the lateral thrust is restrained. Is the lateral thrust restrained on my model? How? Two little wooden things. Wouldn't it be cool if I could pull those little wooden things out and see whether the arch can actually carry load without them? Huh. Isn't that amazing? I can do that. Ah, what? Wrestler is a liar. He lies. It's carrying load just fine. Oh. The value of lateral thrust. Okay, so now you see what makes an arch, and now my message to you is that if we now look at arched structures down through the ages, from the first century BC, really, to the present day, and if we look carefully at how those arches reside within a larger structure, a larger building or a larger bridge, we're going to see this fundamental characteristic. The need for restraint of lateral thrust reflected in the architecture of virtually every building that's constructed using arches from this point forward. Let's test this hypothesis and look at some examples. Here's the basic arch carrying load and compression with reactions in both vertical and horizontal directions at the base. Some of the very earliest uses of arches in the Roman world were used simply as openings in walls. This is the Porta Marina, the gate on the river end of the city of Pompeii and the city wall. And the Porta Marina obviously uses arches. It's a great example of some of the earliest use of arches in the Roman world. In the Porta Marina or any other gateway that uses an arch, how is the lateral thrust of the arch restrained? What prevents that arch from spreading out laterally as my model just did so disastrously? What's doing the job? The wall itself, sure. The arch is embedded in a huge, massive wall. So there's no way that arch can spread out. So this is a very conservative, safe application of the arch. It's guaranteed to work. We don't have to worry about the arch spreading out laterally because the wall does a fine job of providing the necessary restraint against lateral thrust. It's no doubt that this is why this is one of the earliest uses of the arch. This is the era when the Romans are just starting to gain confidence with the new structural form, and they're not getting too daring just yet. But very soon we start seeing arches in bridges. We're back at this great bridge in northern Italy, Pont St. Martin. What's restraining the lateral thrust of the arches in the Pont St. Martin? The land, the river valley. If you think about it, if you look at pictures of Roman arches and even most modern arch bridges, you'll see a very common characteristic. They're almost always built in steep river valleys with very robust, rocky riverbanks. Why? Because an arch bridge requires the river valley itself to restrain the lateral thrust. And indeed, visit the Pont St. Martin in northern Italy, and you'll see very, very heavy, robust bedrock on either side of the valley that's providing more than adequate lateral support for the base of the arch. Pretty cool. Okay, but you've probably seen Roman arches that have more than one arch. This is the Pons Fabricius over the Tiber River right in the heart of Rome. For the moment, I want you to ignore this little arch in the center and focus on the two main structural load-carrying arches. Well, very clearly, out here at the ends of each arch, the outer ends, here and here, it's absolutely no different than the Pont St. Martin, right? The lateral thrust of the outer ends of the arches must necessarily be restrained by the riverbanks themselves. And indeed, that's the case. But what about the inner ends of the two arches? What's restraining the lateral thrust of the inner ends? I want you to visualize the two arches. They're being loaded and they're trying to spread out, just like my model did, just like our simple arch did, right? We put it under load, it tries to spread out. What's preventing the inner ends of the two arches from spreading out laterally? The other arch, that's right. In the center of the two arches, each arch is supporting the other one. The architectural term for this system, that is any series of two or more arches set up side by side, is an arcade. An arcade is simply a series of arches. And the most fundamental characteristic of an arcade is all of the internal ends of the arches support each other. One arch, the tendency of one arch to spread out laterally, is actually supporting the adjacent arch. Pretty cool. And so that's the situation we're looking at the center of the Pons Fabricius. Now, before we move on, I have to stop and address the little arched opening in the center of the bridge. Why in the world is that there, apart from the fact that it looks really cool? Why is it there? The Romans were astonishingly clever, creative engineers. They didn't do something like that unless there was a reason. Who can guess the reason? Go ahead. That's a good guess. That's not the principal reason, but that certainly would save some materials. But Romans didn't care too much about economy of materials. They built robust structures that were built to last forever. In fact, there's a wonderful bridge in Spain where the engineer, having completed the bridge, carved in Latin, "This bridge will stand forever, sir." Because of flooding. Right? The Tiber River flooded frequently. And when the floodwaters rise, when the floodwaters are passing through the two arches, no problem. If this center arch weren't here, as the floodwaters rise, the hydraulic pressure of the water impacting the side of the arch bridge creates tremendous force and will absolutely knock over even a massive stone arch like this one. And so what that inner opening did was relieve the pressure by providing a channel for the water to flow through the bridge in a flood event without knocking the bridge down. The bridge is still standing after well over 2,000 years, and so we can be quite confident, and the Tiber has flooded many times, so we can be quite confident that the system works well. Well, if two arches side by side is good, then 52 arches side by side must be even better. And yes, the same principle of the arcade applies here, with the exception of this outermost arch here, where the lateral support is being provided by the hillside. Here, the lateral support is being provided by the hillside. Here and here, the lateral support is being provided by the hillside, and then also on the top tier. But everywhere else, every single remaining arch in this wonderful aqueduct structure is being supported by the two adjacent arches. It's a really wonderfully efficient system, and it's one of the reasons why we see arcades as integral elements of so many different kinds of Roman structures. Well, Romans are amazingly clever people. Look at this system and say, well, the only thing that seems inefficient about it is that we do have to provide enhanced lateral support out here at the ends. Wouldn't it be nice if we could figure out a way to eliminate the need for lateral support out on the ends of the structure? Well, the Romans did. Anybody want to take a guess how they did that? Know it when you see it. Eliminate the ends. Take this triple level arcade and wrap it around and connect it to itself and create one continuous arcade that has no ends. Now every single arch in the structure is being held up by the adjacent ones. And that's the power of the arch and the power of the arcade in this great system perfected by the great Roman engineers. So remember where we started. With the post and lintel system of the classical Greek era, where we have columns with a bridging element over the top of the columns. Clearly, if we want the arch to serve as a substitute for the post and lintel system, as we see it doing, then we also need to address the challenge of what happens when you take an arch and put it up on top of a pair of columns, as you see represented in one of the great Roman triumphal arches, the Arch of Titus. Well, to understand the challenge, probably the best way to do that is, once again, let's build a model. So I'm going to attempt to build a representation of the Arch of Titus
by building my stone arch on top of a pair of columns, and we'll, there it is. Put some little stone shelves in place. And now, just as I did before, I'm going to add voussoirs to the centering. And a pair of voussoirs at a time, working our way toward the top. If you're from Pennsylvania, proudly add the keystone. And now we have our completed arch. We're ready to remove the centering. Finding it much more difficult to get the centering out for some reason. Can anybody explain to me what's going wrong? Why is it so hard for me to get the centering out? What is the arch doing to our structural system?
It's compressing.
Yeah? What's the lateral, what happens, what's the effect of lateral thrust when you put your arch on top of columns? Lateral thrust is still there. What's the effect? Somebody yell it out. Hurry up before this thing falls down. Suspense is building. I don't care about the wood. I care about lateral thrust. What's resisting the lateral thrust right now? Remember before, I had two wooden blocks. There's no wooden blocks anymore. Friction, okay. And it's doing a good job, right? The arch isn't falling apart. But what's the effect of the lateral thrust on my towers, on my columns? How much load do you, what happens if I add just a little bit of extra load to this? What's going to happen to the columns? Think about it. Predict it. Yes, lateral thrust is a tendency of the ends of the arch to splay out sideways. Well, now when you put it on a set of columns, that tendency is going to cause the columns to tip over outward, right? And indeed, that's exactly what happens. Watch. See that? The outer column simply tipped over. That was the effect of lateral thrust of the arches pushing outward. So it was not that the bottom of the arch slipped out, it was that it literally knocked the columns over. Okay? So how in the world are we going to accommodate that situation? Well, once again, if we had time to do the math, and I know how much you would love to do the math, if we had time, it would be very easy to show that that tendency of the lateral thrust of the arch to tip the towers outward can be reduced. The tendency can be controlled in three ways. One way is to make the columns lower. One way is to make the columns themselves wider. Think about it, that makes sense. It's harder for them to tip over if they're wider. And the third way is to make the columns heavier. Okay? Shorter, wider, heavier. If I do all three of those things, I greatly reduce the tendency of the columns to tip over under the action of the lateral thrust of the arch. Oh, by the way, let's look at the Arch of Titus. And what do we see? We see Roman engineers having already intuited what modern engineering science tells us with certainty, that if we don't want the lateral thrust, if we don't want the lateral thrust of this arch to cause the entire structure to topple over, we want to keep the columns relatively short. We want to make them very wide. We want to add lots of weight up on top to increase the stability to prevent them from tipping over. So the Arch of Titus is a perfect representation of the structural cure, one possible structural cure for the tendency of arches sitting on top of columns to tip those columns over. But the Romans didn't stop here. The Romans went much beyond this as a method of controlling lateral thrust, because the Romans had much grander ambitions. This is an artist's rendering of the Basilica of Maxentius in Rome, built in the 4th century. It is an incredible enclosed space with arches and vaults. We could spend an entire hour talking about the incredibly intricate way that the Romans used perpendicular arches and vaults to restrain the lateral thrust of the main arches associated with this central vaulted ceiling. I don't have time to go into that in detail, but recognize that this really represents the epitome of imperial era Roman construction that represents virtuosity in the design of arched structures. And virtually everything about the geometric configuration of this great structure is about controlling the lateral thrust of the arches. Okay? So that's the Roman era. Now, fast forward 1,000 years. The Western Roman Empire has fallen in the wake of barbarian invasions, subsequent Viking invasions of Western Europe. The early Christian church is about the only institution that has survived the fall of the Western Roman Empire. The building of monumental structures has ceased entirely. You know, this is a historical period that's often called the Dark Ages. Historians don't like to call it the Dark Ages anymore, but from an engineering perspective, it was indeed a dark age, as the incredible virtuosity and engineering know-how that was resident in the Roman Empire really did entirely cease to exist and had to be rebuilt from scratch. Around the year 1000, enough stability and prosperity had been restored in the Western world that European civilization began to build monumental structures once again. And those monumental structures were almost entirely churches and castles. And churches, of course, represent a much better illustration of what we're talking about here today. Is there any way to turn down these lights on the front end? Well, let's not worry about it. What I have here on the slide, which you can sort of vaguely make out, are two buildings. On the left is a Roman structure from the year 310, the Basilica of Constantine in Rome. On the right is a quintessential example of an early Christian church. Both of them are basilica-type structures. A very interesting fact about the rise of early Christianity in Western Europe is that in seeking an architectural form to use for churches, for religious gathering places, early Christians did not turn to earlier forms of worship facilities. Right? The early Christians did not look at Roman and Greek temples as models for their churches because early Greek and Roman temples were not buildings of public worship. They were considered to be the home of the god to which the temple was dedicated, and the public was not allowed inside the building. Well, early Christians were looking for a type of architectural form that would facilitate public worship. They needed a space that could accommodate large numbers of people, and so rather than turn to the early Greek and Roman temples, they turned to the Roman basilica as their first attempt to identify an architectural form suitable for Christian worship. And so what you see on the right-hand side is a plain walls, small window openings, but nothing too terribly elaborate. And then on the top, you can see a flat roof. You can't see anything beyond the flat roof, but it turns out that the structure up above that decorative roof is a truss. We've already talked about trusses. And in fact, if you want proof of the fact that there are, in fact, trusses up there, here's another great, wonderful example of an early Christian basilica, the beautiful Church of San Miniato al Monte in Florence. And here, if you look closely, you can see there is no decorative ceiling up here. You can, in fact, see the wooden roof trusses, which still exist to this day and are still holding up the roof. So how does this structural system work? It's really simple. Let me illustrate its capacity for load carrying by using this simple loading device. And I've just got a stack of steel washers that I use as the basis for representing the roof loads applied to the structure. So what's going on here? I have a large downward force corresponding to the weight of the roof and the loads up on top of the roof pushing down on the truss. As we've already seen, a truss is a completely self-contained structural element. And so there's no lateral thrust associated with its load carrying. And so the truss is simply supported with reactions out on the ends. Those reactions are translated into pure compressive force directed down through these walls. There's no lateral thrust, so there's no tendency of the walls to tip outward. And so the walls are relatively thin. They don't have to be terribly robust. We can't have any large window openings. And if you look closely, you'll see that the windows are all located midway between the trusses so that that compressive force that's transmitted down through the walls has a nice, clear load path to follow from the base of the truss all the way down to the foundation of the building. Okay, very simple, very straightforward structural system, very easy to implement. Well, now we're going to fast forward just another 100 years, and we enter an architectural area that has been characterized as Romanesque. It's called Romanesque because during this era, builders in the Middle Ages became more aware of the ruins of the great vaulted structures of Imperial Rome and tried to emulate those forms in the form of more monumental Christian buildings, more monumental churches. Vézelay Abbey, which was built around 1100, is a wonderful example, quintessential example of Romanesque architecture. What's different? Well, the most critical difference between the Romanesque and the early Christian basilica is that now, rather than simply having roof trusses overhead and a decorative wooden ceiling, we are now enclosing the building with these very heavy stone arches and vaults. This is solid stone from one end of the church to the other. In other words, we're going to put a huge arch structure as the enclosing element of this building. Well, let me convert my model from early Christian basilica into Romanesque church. And to do that, to represent that, I'm simply going to add this arch. Whoa. I don't know how to add it. Well, let's look. If you look closely at Vézelay Abbey, you'll see that what the builders of the Romanesque era did was to build projecting elements, which are called engaged columns, projecting out from the inside edges of the wall. So here's a typical example of an engaged column, which I'll just plug into the side of the wall here. And that effectively provides the base on which we can add our vaulted roof. And, oh, by the way, you can't see it, but guess what there is up above the stone vaulting? A truss. Now you may be asking, wait, why in the world are we doing this? We have this beautiful, elegantly carved, solid stone ceiling, if you will. Why in the world would you put a wooden truss up on top of that? Well, the answer is that the truss and the vaults have a symbiotic relationship with each other. What is the method we use to illuminate a medieval church on the inside? How do you provide lighting? Stained glass a little bit later. We'll get to that. Candles, sure. Candles, torches, open flames. So the vaulting, which is made of stone, is providing an invaluable service by protecting the wooden trusses from fire. But the wooden trusses are at the same time protecting the vaulting from the elements. Stone vaulted construction is highly susceptible to freezing and thawing. Somebody earlier talked about the cracking of stone that occurs when it gets wet, and then it freezes in the wintertime, it expands and it pulverizes. So those beautiful stone vaults, if they were the outer protective surface of the building, they wouldn't be there now. They would have been reduced to rubble. What has prevented them from being reduced to rubble is the fact that there's a wooden truss up above and a solid roof that keeps the vaults dry. Okay? So with that in mind now, we're ready to test our revised Romanesque building to determine its load-carrying characteristics. So once again, I'm going to put my loading device here, and we're going to start adding some load. And what I want you to do is watch carefully as I add loads. Notice I'm putting load in place a little bit more carefully than I did before. Watch the walls of our structure. Watch what's happening as I add load. By the way, the truss is masking that effect a little bit, so I'm going to just take the truss off so you can see it more clearly. See the tendency of the arches to cause the walls to tip outward? This is a product. There it is. Okay, so there's the failure in progress. Unfortunately, I've caught it before I destroyed my model. And a clear evidence of the new challenge that the Romanesque builders have incurred as a consequence of having shifted from just a purely truss-based roof to a heavy stone-vaulted roof. Remember that my earlier structure carried washers stacked all the way up to here, and now I can only carry a tiny fraction of them. I have a structure that really isn't robust enough to stand the test of time. So how did the Romanesque builders deal with this situation? Well, remember, there are three things that can, when we put an arch on top of a column, there are three things that resist its tendency to tip. What's one? Three things. What were the three ways that the Romans did it in the Arch of Titus? could make it shorter, okay? Architecturally, that's not really an option here because we want our building to be a certain height. So that of the three options, that's the one that's really not practical. What are the two others? Heavier and wider. Heavier and wider. So how did Romanesque builders cause their walls to be heavier and wider? They invented something called a buttress. The buttress is an extension of the wall itself, located precisely at the location of the main load-carrying arches. And the purpose of the buttress is to add both width and mass. And now with the addition of the buttresses, I can put my loading device back on, and you'll see that I can now add substantial additional load to the structure. You know, it was right on the verge of collapse before, and now I can add a lot of additional weight, and the buttresses have added the necessary stability. So why are we talking about this? Because if you open up your architecture textbook and you read about Romanesque architecture, it will tell you the aesthetic characteristics of the Romanesque are semicircular arches, which mimic the Roman arches, very heavy columns, thick walls, small windows, and ample use of buttresses on the exterior of the buildings. By the way, this is Vézelay Abbey, and again, it's not too clear with our washed-out screen, but if you look over here, you see a series of buttresses which are functioning precisely the same way as the buttresses are on my model. So those characteristic features of Romanesque architecture, heavy columns, thick walls, small windows, wide buttresses, are all direct reflections of the need to resist the lateral thrust of heavy stone arched vaults placed up on the tops of columns. Features which we think of as aesthetic architectural features are at the most fundamental level about structural load carrying. Okay, now let's bring it home. This is Spire Cathedral, another great example of Romanesque form. Let's take another leap in time, another 100 years, to the era known as the Gothic era, at least in architectural form. The Gothic era just represents another major leap forward in architectural progress. The architects of the Gothic era, particularly as they applied their skills to designing and building churches and great cathedrals, was all about glorifying God through architectural forms that exemplify height and light. Height and light. That is, we want to create soaring vertical lines that draw the eye up to the heavens to glorify God. We want to create huge wide open windows with beautiful stained glass that allow the heavenly light to filter into the nave of the church, filling it with the ethereal light that reminds us of the love of God. And we want to do this in stone architecture. Well, how do we do that in stone architecture? Obviously, if we're going to design a building that exemplifies height and light, we've got to make the columns smaller so that the windows can be larger. We've got to make the columns much taller. What's the problem? If you wanted to create a problem with lateral thrust in a vaulted building, what would be the best way to do it? It would be to make your columns really thin and make them really tall. And then you create a situation under which the lateral thrust is going to have a tremendous tendency to tip the walls outward. So how did the Gothic builders address this challenge? I mean, we saw that we could just barely get the heavy, bulky, Romanesque cathedral to be able to stand up by using buttresses. How in the world are we going to handle the lateral thrust of the arch now that we've made the structure significantly taller and significantly lighter? Well, the first attempt or the first element of the solution to the problem can be found in one of the other characteristic features of Gothic architecture, the pointed arch. You know, the pointed arch is not an invention of medieval builders. We know that there are examples of pointed arches in Islamic architecture from prior to the medieval era. There's a lot of scholarly controversy about why pointed arches were first developed. Some people say, it's attempting to represent two hands praying. Some people say it was an attempt to emulate the appearance of trees arching over a roadway and creating that sort of pointed archway. But there is a critically important structural reason as well. Because it turns out that the lateral thrust of an arch for a given span The lateral thrust of an arch, mathematically speaking, is inversely proportional to the height of the arch. That is to say, the taller the arch, the lower the lateral thrust. So it's no coincidence that pointed arches coincide with the development of Gothic architecture, because the Gothic builders needed every means available to control the lateral thrust of their arches, and the pointed arch was one important element of that solution. So I'll now add a pointed arch to our structure, and clearly the pointed arch is going to solve a problem. So I'll just take my loading device here and I'll just add it to, whoa, clearly this is not a solution to our problem. So the pointed arch is part of the solution to the problem, but it clearly isn't the entire solution. Does anybody know what the new revolutionary architectural and structural innovation that the Gothic builders brought to the table in order to solve this problem? Anybody know what it is? Anybody ever heard of it? It is one of the most characteristic features of Gothic structures, and it is called the flying buttress. Thank you very much. I wish I had some flying buttresses here to show you. Oh, look, here's a pair. Here are the flying buttresses. And let me quickly advance the slide to the extent that we can see it. If you look really closely, you can see these structures here. That's a tall post, and then a series of half arches connecting to the main building. Again, a tall post and a series of open half arches that connect to the building. The flying buttress is really essentially a separate structure that stands outside of the nave of the building itself, but plugs into it from the outside. So here's the basic configuration of our Gothic cathedral with its flying buttresses in place. And furthermore, the Gothic builders were not simply satisfied with the flying buttresses. You'll notice that every one of these things has a tall pinnacle on top of it. And most people simply believe the pinnacles are there for aesthetic effect. In fact, those pinnacles are massive stone elements that significantly increase the weight of the buttress. And remember, the key elements that stabilize the lateral thrust of the arch are mass and width. So what the flying buttresses do is tremendously increase the base width of the supporting structure and tremendously increase its mass, so that now when we add this very substantial load to our arch, carries load with no problem at all. And once again, just like the Romanesque churches, the Gothic churches included a truss up on top of the structure to protect the arches from the elements. So once again, we see, open up your architectural textbook, turn to the chapter on Gothic, and you'll read what the aesthetic characteristics of the Gothic are: pointed arches, flying buttresses, pinnacles, ribbed vaults. Yes, they are aesthetic architectural elements, but they are structural elements as well. In fact, they're absolutely integral to the ability of these grand structures to carry load, and the reason that these grand structures are still in existence today. So what does all this have to do with the world of today? The arch is still an extraordinarily common element in the most modern of structures. This is the Gateway Arch in St. Louis, really just emblematic of many arch structures you'll see even here on campus. And they all work exactly the same way. They all are subject to the same challenges: a structural element that carries load principally in compression and which must have a purposefully designed system for restraining lateral thrust. Indeed, if you go visit St. Louis and visit the Gateway Arch, you'll find that the foundations of that structure down below the shoreline of the Mississippi River are really extraordinarily, entirely on par with the sophistication of the flying buttresses that you see in the Gothic Cathedral. And everything we've talked about with respect to the arch is equally applicable to another critically important structural form, and that is the dome. You ever go to visit Florence and the great Cathedral of Santa Maria del Fiore and see the great dome all over the cathedral built by the great Renaissance engineer architect Filippo Brunelleschi, what you're really seeing there is an arch that's been extruded into three dimensions, around a circle, and everything about that dome behaves in the same way. All the same considerations are present as we saw in our Gothic cathedral. And Brunelleschi had to cope with those challenges in much the same way as the medieval architects did. And so once again, you see that architecture is profoundly influenced by structure. And now as you go forth and you see great structures in the world around you, you see arches, you'll be able to look at them and appreciate them much more deeply in a much more profound way by virtue of recognizing that beneath that arch is structural function, which is absolutely integral to both its appearance and its performance, its role in holding up that structure and causing it to last so we can appreciate it many years later.